Welcome to Unity of Ocala. I'm Joanne Long. I'm your platform speaker this morning. And let us begin with an opening prayer. Dear Father, Mother, God, we are grateful for the natural world and the changing of the seasons. For everything, there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. And so it is with the human race. Awaken us to the ever-evolving divine consciousness in each individual and grant us patience, awareness, and acceptance as we experience changes and what are perceived by us as challenges. God, be our guide and our comforter. May we ever have an open heart, and may we ever be grateful for your divine presence here with us at Unity of Ocala and wherever people gather in your name as we honor all paths to God. Amen. And a music video, I believe it's We Are Unity.
We are one, but we are different. Made from all around.
Let's speak together. Unity's foundational principle. There is only one power, one presence active in the universe and in my life, God the good, omnipotent. And when we live this principle, we are a thriving spiritual community here to inspire one another to realize God's love. Centered Spirit of God, we see peace, love, and abundance in an awakening world. And the daily word for Sunday, October 24th, 2021, is passion. My purpose fuels my passion. Purpose sets my heart aflame with passion. Each day I awaken, ready to answer the call of my heart, to give my best efforts and fullest attention to purposeful activity. Passion is the energy that I bring to everything I do. I discover the glory of God through passion as I do the things that make me feel the most alive, that fill me with energy and zeal and color the world with hope and promise. I recognize the divine presence behind it all. God is the source of all the passion I feel and the purpose that drives me. My passion is not for me alone. The life energy that radiates from me inspires those around me to live a life of purpose and passion, to boldly express their divinity as only they can. And from 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 11, whoever speaks must do so as one speaking the very words of God. Whoever serves must do so with the strength that God supplies. And another video, I Am Light by India Ari.
mistakes that I have made. Where are the things that cause me pain? I'm not the pieces of the dream I left behind. I am light. I am light. I am light.
Now. And last week we spoke a little bit about psychosynthesis, and during our sacred conversations discussion, I mentioned that we're going to do an exercise today during that time of discussion that I'll explain more in my talk, but really helps us become and recognize that which God designed us to be, because we often cover it with these masks that we wear throughout life. And so in this meditation, I'd like to start that process by clearing out and opening all the passages that may block us from fully experiencing these meditations. So you are safe here. You are happy here in this cheerful, beautiful space. Thank you all for coming yesterday to clean up the grounds. It looks fabulous. Thank you for that. So let's get comfy and just settle in. I invite you to take some nice deep cleansing breaths and get that circulation cleaning out, nurturing the cells, releasing the old. So just take off anything from your lap or your heart or your mind that might distract you. This is your time. Your sacred time with God, your time to be nurtured, to be loved, to be healed, to be filled, to be led, to be free. So breathe into this space and relax. We're going to start at the very top of the scalp, the crown, just above the crown, that seventh chakra, that halo that we all wear. Just imagine that as a shower of light, of a vibration of God's energy, always there, that we become more aware of when we become still. Go within. You are never alone. That presence is with you wherever you are. Notice how your body is attracted to a calming, an easing, a relaxing. Breathe. Allow that light to just begin to pour through your scalp, just relaxing, opening, cleansing. Do a scan of that whole cranial area. Notice any blocks, any heaviness, any tingling. Just observe. Become in tune with your internal. Behind your eyes, behind your brows, deep within your ears, God is at work. Allow your brain to calm down, not process. Relax. Just allow your sinuses to open fully and breathe easily. This allows your muscles to be restored and healed. It takes all the pressure away from the veins, the arteries, so that the blood supply can easily flow, nurturing, restoring, invigorating. Just imagine your whole body as a temple, a chalice. The energy, the light, the love of God just easily flows through like a free waterfall, restoring completely. Feel your throat opening, the truth of who you are being born right now. Your shoulders relaxing. Your joints eased, the muscles in your arms relaxing, your elbows, your forearms, your wrists, fingertips, palms, tingling with new energy. Feel God's light through your chest, through your rib cage, your organs, down your spine, through each vertebrae, each bone. What a miraculous creation you are. Feel that energy vibrate, massage your belly, your lower back, your hips especially, releasing the old toxins stored there through your thighs, your knees, your calves, your shins, your ankles. Move your feet around. Loosen, loosen. Your body is refreshed. A simple moment of stillness restores energy, vitality. Breathe. Now we're just going to travel back to perhaps your earliest memory. Do you see yourself as a child? Free? Adorable? Just observe. No judgment. You are a spectator, watching a play, you as a child. Memories will float up, just allow, observe your journey. Observe the masks you've worn, your name. Are you called a brother, a sister, a friend, a cousin? A student, a playmate, all of it, no labels, a teenager, a young adult,
an athlete, a bookworm. Dreamy, artistic, fun-loving, ornery, stubborn, joyous, curious. Sad, happy, cheerful, excited, lovely, lovable, loving. Perhaps you're a spouse, an aunt, an uncle, a mother, a father. A worker. Notice the beautiful rainbow of your life. Now allow yourself to feel that every event has played its part in the development of the beauty of you. We look on that journey with God's compassion, God's joy, shining the light on all the jewels in which the challenges have polished into a glorious shine of who we are. And now we look forward and imagine in your mind a brand new page turning, a new chapter before us. On that page, that canvas, just allow that deep goddess and godness in you to begin to design that page. Allow your imagination to open and just observe any colors, any sounds, any memories, dreams, discoveries, desires. Just let those bloom in there like flowers popping open. Just enjoy. In the quiet, take a few moments to just watch, listen. God is revealing to you at all times the truth of who you are through the eyes of love. Just watch. You continue to enjoy this sweet communion, this space of sacred grace. Allow yourself, give yourself permission to feel in your heart how deeply, eternally you are loved, you are cherished. By your Creator, you are is designing the colors, the fabric, the tapestry of your life more incredibly than you could ever imagine. Know that through every fiber of your being, God's got you. God's got you. As we bring our attention back to this space and time, let us be reminded to keep that channel open. To keep the curiosity of our inner child alive. To expect the beautifully unexpected. To be open for miracles. To be appreciative of this journey. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Amen. 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 That felt good. I could just stay there the rest of the day. But I won't. Didn't that feel good? Don't you just feel good? Just want to walk through the flowers. We spoke a little bit last week about psychosynthesis, as was begun and developed by Roberto Assagiole, an Italian psychiatrist who was a student of Freud but disagreed with him on a few matters. Don't you love that when you're a teacher? And you, or when you're especially a student and you have a teacher that lets you disagree and challenges. Charles Fillmore was one of those great teachers who would say, yes, this is what I believe today, but come tomorrow and challenge me with new evidence and I may change my mind. I love that about a teacher, but they disagreed. Freud really spent his practice on the limitations of the self, the limitations of the ego. And Roberto recognized early on in his work that there was something in each individual uniquely divine that went beyond the capabilities of the personality. In other words, and he developed an entire practice which now has an institution which psychoanalysis and psychologists, psychiatrists are using to this day, the Institute of Psychosynthesis, he realized that there is that in us that is a divine spark. Now, he was deeply attracted to Eastern philosophy. He was jailed at one point. I don't know what for. I haven't really done that much research on that aspect of him. But he was in solitary confinement for about 30 days, 30 or 45 days, where he used those Eastern practices and techniques of meditation to go deeply within his inner self. And he realized that what he was practicing in his work was indeed showing him this pathway to this inner divinity, which he recognized as the soul. Some in his field of work would recognize that as the spirit of God, the spirit of creation, the force of creation, subatomic particles, wherever you are in that scientific field. But there is within us access to this divine wisdom, this divine knowing. And for whatever reasons, we block it and put a cap on its growth and development to its full potential. I believe Jesus had reached this full potential beyond the cap of the personality. Hi, Gab. And was able to go beyond the limits of the ego. And Roberto began to realize where the limitations began to come. He worked a lot with children, particularly traumatized children, but then realized that all children are traumatized in one way or another. Some obviously needing extraordinary help. But he realized that all children across the spectrum have some trauma. It's part of life. It's part of the journey. And scars are scars, No matter how deep or how light, we can't compare them to others. They're unique to us because we're individuals. But those traumas allow us to develop these personality traits that protect us as children. In extreme cases, like I mentioned last week, of trauma, that child will actually unknowingly, subconsciously, unconsciously develop different personalities, multiple personalities. This we've all read about, seen movies about, Sybil, classic example, where extreme trauma allows the brain to develop a whole different entity that can take the pain when that child can't. That's extraordinary what the brain can do. But he developed this understanding and knowledge and now a practice that that happens to all of us. And those of us that may not be as affected as terribly traumatized children, just kind of poo-poo it away. Oh yeah, I have abandonment issues. My father died when I was 9. But you should see this poor thing over here who had this happen to, you know. We always tend to, well, I'm not quite as bad as that because, you know, it's I'm fine. I'm fine. There's a book out right now that it's called I'm Fine. Have you seen it? The cover says it all. I can't think of the author now. I'll think of it in a minute. I'm having one of those moments. I'll think about it. 2 a.m. I'll send it out to you all. And the cover is this woman who is in water up to here. And above the water is her perfectly coiffed hair, perfect makeup. And underneath, her legs are sprayed, her children are floating, everything is disaster. It is underwater, it is flooded. And she's just smiling, I'm fine. And I think, that's all of us. And he also recognized, Roberto recognized that these societal demands that are placed on children and on all of us, these impossible perfections that we are required to pretend we have are inachievable. They're for advertising or whatever. But there is no way perfection exists in human form. It cannot. There is no perfect job, perfect marriage, perfect husband, perfect spouse, perfect children. But we all want to pretend that just to survive, I'm as good as the Joneses. I'll go ahead and get another car because I think I'm supposed to. I guess I'll get that degree because I think I'm supposed to. I better buy that dress because it's really popular now. I better get that friend. And we condition our children to do this. So no wonder we're carrying that with us. But those types of limitations we know are in us also cap that spiritual growth. So he spent his entire life practice developing these resources and exercises that help us identify where in our childhood we started capping our growth potential. And it can happen at various times of your journey. You know, we can go to, when I went through this experience, my little 9-year-old came out and she was mad. I thought it would be my sassy 16-year-old that knew everything, was running off with the boys, doing bad things. And I thought that's who would come out and confront me. No, it was my 9-year-old on the day of my father's funeral. And I had forgot that day. I had forgot that year. We tend to do that. It's another protective mechanism that we have. She was mad. And we were then to go back to our dorm room, Unity Village, and have a dialogue with this part of our personality that came out that had so much to tell us. And it was interesting. I won't go into to what she shared with me until after our session today because I don't want to color anybody's experience at all. But there are parts of ourself that still need to be heard, embraced, dialogued with. And this is a beautiful exercise for all of us to just learn and take with us in our meditation practice. And I mention this, and I want to do this work now because especially the last, I would say, 30 to 45 days, after the whole pandemic, I've probably done more counseling in the last 18 to 24 months than I did in the previous 18 years from people that I would not expect. You know, in ministry, you get the typical around the holidays, you know, those that have lost spouses, you go into stuff when somebody loses someone, when, you know, you go, there's those typical moments. But the spectrum's
been very broad. And what I'm noticing are some trends, some things that are very collective in the psyche of those that I have been speaking with. There is an underlying trauma that is being triggered in all of us as a society. Well, it's no wonder. I mean, come on, look what we've all been through collectively. We kind of want to, okay, let's go back to normal. That didn't happen. We're all good. The water's up to here. And there's a collective anxiety and a, it's like a, what is it? But I can't put my finger on it. I can't really fix it. I don't know what it is. Yeah? You're all kind of feeling that. And for those who may have had some challenges with depression before or anxiety before, that's heightened. For some of you that have always been happy and mellow and all of a sudden things irritate you and certain people you just want to hang up on, and we don't hang up like that anymore. We do this. But there's triggers. There's unresolved issues. But this is a good thing. When you're getting those triggers, don't be upset with yourself. Don't take a bunch of pills. Well, if you have to, please do. But don't fret it. This is that child in you saying, I'm ready to take the cap off of you. I'm ready to reach my full potential. I want to share a couple of thoughts of the founding father of Psychosynthesis Institute. And if you're interested in this work, go to the website. Just Google Psychosynthesis. And you'll go right to the Institute. And it explains their whole vision and mission and his work and how they've expanded on it. That Institute was developed in, I think, 1973. So it's really evolved into what it is. But the site explains psychosynthesis as an approach to psychology that expands the boundaries of that field by identifying a deeper center of identity, which is the postulate of the self. Something deep within all of us that goes beyond the human experience. It's there. It's recognized. It's been identified. It considers each individual unique in terms of purpose in life. And he also discovered that people often, most often, do not even find their true purpose until much later in life. Like the palm tree reaches its most beautiful plumage and fruit well past 100 years. So be happy. If you're feeling that discontent of, am I being all, why am I getting triggered? What am I doing now? What am I going to do next? Now what? Martin Buber wrote, everyone must come out of his exile in his own way. The whole book of Exodus in the Hebrew Bible metaphysically represents our escape from this human condition while still on earth, developing, finding, living, and experiencing the kingdom of heaven. Jesus got this. And he understood that each one of us had that divine spark. It's not me, but the Father in me, and even you will do this and even greater things. Focus on that which is lovely and true. And this process of psychosynthesis is a compassionate way to look at our individual journeys, not through the eyes of shame, not that type of therapy. This is good therapy, healthy, progressive therapy. And we look at those moments of shame and fear and guilt and resentment and all of that garbage that was heaped on us or that we heaped on us with the eyes of God. And instead of saying, how could I have done that? How did I let, who was I? We say, how could I not have? Given the circumstances that I understood at the time, there was no other way. So we can just let that garbage go right away. You are blameless. Everyone is when they don't know what they're doing. Yes. Behind all our masks. Yes. I love those maskless. Just completely maskless. Don't you? Behind all our masks resides a deeper knowledge of self that can be felt, that can be nurtured, strengthened with compassion and attention and disidentification of those masks that we wear. Finding meaning and purpose. So that's what we're going to do. This type of psychology focuses on three areas: self, will, and hope. Will, we tend to use the Victorian definition of will. A person has a strong will or a tough will. It's not the will that this practice deals with. It is the will of God, the will in us that desires to become that which we've been created to be. So if you're feeling that discontent, that anxiety, you might be reverting to old habits, to old feelings. You may have been healed through psychology and all of a sudden you're having relapse after relapse. This is a good thing, because now your spirit is saying, I'm ready to take all the caps off. Let's begin. Excited? Yes. I think, I don't know, what are you going to do to me? This is a very simple, easy, you could do this anytime that you want, to just go in and have an open dialogue with your inner self and those parts of God. And the great thing about it is you don't have to do anything. So if nothing comes up, that's fine. Lots of things come up, that's fine too. It's all God work. You're safe. It's a joy. So, as we go into this next part of our service, I just want to leave with you this. This is a sweet little Paramahansa Yogananda. It's his writings, which some of you light up when you hear him. He's such a sweet, sweet, sweet teacher. And this is Metaphysical Meditations. One of my friends just gave me this sweet little book that just has the, well, he was such a beautiful writer, and just such a lover of souls and of human beings and of Jesus. I mean, they were like brothers, right? And he wrote, and I read this morning, and I'm just keeping this with me all weekend. So take this into the meditation we do during class and throughout the day. Today I will worship God in deep silence and wait to hear his answer through my increasing peace of meditation. I will mingle my inner devotional whispers with the prayers of all saints who are with me and continuously offer them in the temples of silence and activity until I can hear his whispers loudly everywhere. This day shall be the best day of my life. Today I will start with a new determination to dedicate my devotion forever at the feet of omnipresence. Oh, thank you. Thank you for being here today. We have a video, yes? Music? Maybe. If not, we can all listen to JJ. His voice is musical to me. Music to my ears. Wait till I start bringing my little ones. This place is going to get loud. Let's talk about triggers, right? While we wait.
Deep within my heart, I know you've won. I know you've overcome. And even in the dark, when
Announcements. Jean, would you like to do some announcements? Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, of course. So, you want to sing now? Yeah. And I think you guys are good at songs.
Yay! Oh, I take it in. Yay! Thank you. best birthday ever. Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. What do we do next? Oh, our tithing, right? Oh, I want to thank all of you for supporting this ministry through this time of pandemic. It's the strangest thing for ministers. I got hired and closed the doors the next day. We had to have an emergency meeting to say, okay, thank you for hiring me, now leave. But we have developed some amazing techniques. We have a virtual congregation out there. Our tithes have been strong. Our donations to the community have been equally as strong. We are a force in this community doing God's work. So thank you for your physical support, your financial support, your volunteering, your love, your joy, your prayer. We are moving and shaking because of you. So thank you. This world needs us. So thank you. Let us say with divine intention our prayer for our tithings together. Divine love flowing in and through me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. And I am grateful. I am. And our prayer box, let us pay sacred attention to the prayers in here. And if you haven't already and would like someone prayed on or prayed with, put their name in here. Our prayer chaplains hold them, hold the high watch for these names for 30 days. We send them to Silent Unity, and they are held for an additional 30 days, the high watch. So let us direct our attention, our love, our energy to these names. Thank you, God, for this opportunity to open for your guidance and your love. We release these souls to you, knowing that you got them. Their highest good is now being sought. And for that, we are so grateful. Thank you, God. Amen. Our children, let's bring up our stars, our bright stars. Yay! You got your shoes off. Hi! He's not at all independent, is he, Gab? You're the best big sister. Hi. Let us say our prayer for our bright lights. We love you. We appreciate you. We see you loved, guided, and protected. And we see you to do great things. Yay! Now, he likes it up here. Yeah. Yeah, huh? You can stay up here with me. Yeah. Bye, Mom. You can stay with me? Yeah? Let's stand and say our prayer together. You waving bye to Mom? Yeah? The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. Oh, thank you. Okay. We are, God is, and all is well. Yay! No way, Jose. He likes that, yes. You can be up here all you want. Okay, so let's come back 10 minutes. And we will have our exercise.